class. Today I want to distinguish more clearly for you between three different kinds of sources: the primary source, the secondary source, and the tertiary source. You've all been told that you shouldn't be using Wikipedia as a source in your college level research, but why exactly? What's the problem with Wikipedia? It isn't really that Wikipedia is written by a bunch of knuckleheads who get together and create an encyclopedia together. Many of the people who work on Wikipedia are actually experts in their fields and write pretty well and pretty effectively, and they police one another. Some studies have shown that Wikipedia is actually better than sources like Encyclopedia Britannica, which is written exclusively by qualified scholars. So the problem with Wikipedia isn't fundamentally the fact that it's written by anyone who wants to add to it. The problem with Wikipedia is that it, like Encyclopedia Britannica, is a tertiary source and not a secondary source. So what then is a secondary source? How do we define that, and how is it different from a tertiary source? Well, to understand that, we need to go back to the primary source and what makes a source primary. A primary source, as we've discussed pretty extensively in class, is a fragment of the past. It's something that comes to us out of the lost past and helps us and gives us a window on that culture. Something that was published in the period, something that was written in the period, something that remains to us. Life magazine, we've talked about pretty extensively. There are newspaper articles that you can get access to online through the BU Library website. But there are other things like letters from presidents. This is a collection of Dwight D. Eisenhower's papers. It's one of the things that you can get hold of using the BU Library website. And this, for instance, is a letter written by the president, a cable, written to Chiang Kai-shek, the leader of China, what we now call Taiwan, in this period. So this is a primary source, just like Life magazine is, in the sense that it's something that was written and remains to us out of a distant and lost past. A secondary source is a book or an article written about the past by a scholar, and it's based predominantly on primary sources. How can we tell that Abundance and Anxiety, America 1945 to 1960, is a scholarly source, a secondary source? Well, for one thing, the name suggests a certain kind of scholarly inquiry. But for another thing, it has footnotes, and footnotes help us trace back to the origin of what where the scholar is getting his information. But the thing that makes this most importantly a secondary source, the most important quality, is that it's based predominantly on primary sources. Gary Donaldson has taken the time to study documents that out of the lost past and synthesize what he's learned to produce this book. To a certain extent, he is writing in response to other secondary sources. Good scholarship is always responding to other scholarship. So yes, he will also footnote secondary sources, but fundamentally what makes something true in his analysis is that he's basing it on primary source evidence. Probably not Life magazine, but almost certainly diplomatic cables like the one you see here. By contrast, Wikipedia, the Encyclopedia Britannica, and books like this one are tertiary sources. They're written sometimes by scholars, sometimes by amateur historians, sometimes by people who just decide to contribute to Wikipedia, but in all cases, their knowledge of the past is based predominantly on reading secondary sources and reading other tertiary sources. So this book, for instance, this looks at first glance like, oh, look, it's a book on Dwight D. Eisenhower. Maybe I'll use this for my essay or for my written report. But if you look at the print, the number of words on the page suggests maybe this isn't really an academic book, but maybe something written for kids in junior high or high school. If I look at the cover and I learn that it's about the presidential leaders, published by Lerner Publications Company. And as I page through, this feels more like a biography than real scholarship. one of the signs I was going to say that it's not a terribly scholarly book is its lack of footnotes. But it's possible for a tertiary source to have footnotes. And in fact, if you think about it, the written reports that you guys just completed are tertiary sources. They are coherent accounts about the past based primarily on secondary sources. They use primary sources only in passing as illustrations. They don't use primary sources as sources of evidence. So you've actually created tertiary sources that have footnotes. Wikipedia is also a tertiary source that has footnotes. So determining whether something is a secondary or a tertiary source, it's not just a question of footnotes. It's a question of what the scholar is up to. Is the scholar simply reporting what other experts believe, or is the scholar taking what other experts think as a starting point and pushing knowledge to a new level of understanding? Ideally, when you're creating a tertiary source, you should be working from secondary sources as your primary source of, or as your main source of proof, just as when you're creating a secondary source, you should be working from primary sources as your main source of proof. So in conclusion, I don't want you to think, to walk away from this thinking that you should never consult Wikipedia. Wikipedia is a great place to start learning about a topic. Encyclopedia Britannica, a great place to start learning about a topic. Even books like this one, written perhaps for people a little bit younger than you, might be an okay place to start learning about a topic. But it's not a great place to finish. None of these places put you in a position to speak really in a learned way about Eisenhower. And none of them are something impressive enough that you'd want to write home to mom about them. You'd want to cite them in a footnote. So use these as jumping off points, learning the very basic basics. Then graduate to books like this to really find out what true experts have to say about the topic. That then will qualify you for writing a written report, for creating a annotated bibliography. It's books like this one, journal articles, that you want to put in your annotated bibliography. And then, in the next phase of this, you're going to be digging up primary sources of your own, a body of evidence to serve you as a basis for writing your own essay. If your written report is a tertiary source, a useful sort of starting point for other students, your essay, when we get to that, will be, if you do it well, a genuine secondary source, a contribution, an original contribution to scholarship on your topic. And I look forward to reading those. Thanks very much.